pa.
Hello guys,
ano yung time 5 lang ba? Yeah, I think it's already 1 o'clock. We can start the webinar. So good afternoon to one and all present, respected deans, head of departments, lecturers, distinguished speakers, Ms. Agnes Hernadi and Ms. Eunice Redith Manalo, my dear students and ladies and gentlemen. Mabuhay! Welcome to our first joint e-webinar between Atmajaya Catholic University of Indonesia and Davao Del Norte State College. My name is Chitra, and I will be your host and moderator. Thank you for your time, for taking the time to join us today as we talk about recognizing tourism potential, Jakarta and Mindanao as tourist destinations. The issue of tourism has been a hot topic during this pandemic era. It is one of the industry that has taken a big hit because of this pandemic. Hopefully it will be over soon and that we will be able to live the new normal where we can start again to take a break or holiday in our country or outside our country without fear. I believe today's topic is an interesting topic because I know that most of us here know Indonesia and the Philippines by name only. We know that both are a part of the Asia ASEAN countries and that the capitals are Jakarta and Manila. But we do not know much more than that. We do not know that we actually have a lot in common. We both have rich and deep culture, beautiful sceneries, wonderful food, as well as centuries of colonialization that also integrate and becomes a part in enriching our culture. Well, I am fortunate enough to be able to live in the Philippines during my graduate time. So I know personally how warm and friendly the people are, how beautiful the landscape is, and how delicious the food are, right? Like right now, I'm still craving for chicken inasal Max Chicken, Beef Tapa, Liempo, and Halo Halo, which I cannot find here. So I believe that by the end of this e-webinar, you will all understand more about these two countries and hopefully also have the desire to visit these countries on your next holiday. But before we start, I would like for our presenters to introduce themselves a little bit to our audience. So I would like to ask for Ms. Harnadi to introduce herself and then followed by Ms. Manalo.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear my voice?
Yes.
Okay.
It's clear.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. First of all, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Agnes Harnadi from Tourism Department, Catholic University, Atmajaya Catholic University of Indonesia. Actually, I didn't graduate from tourism. I have degree from industrial engineering, bachelor degree, and I continued my study in business innovation and technology management at University of Girona or Universitat de Girona in Spain. And now I'm lecturer of tourism department in Atmajaya. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Harnadi and Ms. Manalo. Could you please tell a little bit about yourself?
So once again, good afternoon to each and everyone. Am I loud and clear po?
Yes.
And so my name is Eunice Reddit S. Manalo, and I am one of the faculty member of the Bachelor of Science in Tourism Management program under the Institute of Leadership and Good Governance from the Davao del Norte State College. So I graduated Bachelor of Science in Tourism Management, and I am currently taking up a Master in Business Administration. So I was supposed to take Master's in International Tourism and Hospitality Management, but by the time that I was enrolled, by the time that the program was offered here in the Davao region, I was already in my second year in Master in Business Administration. So I am currently pursuing the Master in Business Administration. So I've been in the college since last year, from 2020, but I have already approximately around 4 years of teaching experience. The rest is industry experience. I think that would be all, and thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Manalo. So to start our webinar, I would like to ask for Ms. Harnadi to start her presentation about Jakarta and its tourism potential. And the time is yours, Ms. Harnadi.
Okay, thank you, Ma'am Stra. I would share my screen. Wait. Everyone can see the screen, the slide?
Yes, I can see.
Thank you for the opportunity. And now I would like to present recognizing tourism potential of Jakarta. The first, we take a look at Jakarta at glance. As you can see the slide, here are the maps of our country, Indonesia, the archipelago. Jakarta is here in island of Java. We have also Bali in the picture. Bali Island is next to Java. We have also Medan, and I think Philippines is around here approximately, right? And then if we zoom the Jakarta parts, it would be like this. This is Jakarta. And this city is divided to five regions, five areas: the north, the east, the south, the central, and the west. And Atmajaya Catholic University of Indonesia, it's about around here in the border of central and the south of Jakarta. Jakarta is found on June 22nd of 1527, and now, according to 2020, the size of Jakarta is 664 kilometers squares with the population of 6 million, more than 10 million, sorry, and now governed by Anies Baswedan, who was elected in 2019. As a megapolitan city, Jakarta, of course, has its own problem. So first, we have a really bad traffic congestion. Maybe Manila too, I think. Jakarta was named as one of the most congested cities in the world for long ago. And however, in 2020, when there was restriction, there's a pandemic during the COVID-19, Jakarta congestion level decreased to 36% compared to 53% in 2019 before the pandemic. So now Jakarta ranks to 31st according to TomTom Traffic Index. And now in 2021, Jakarta's traffic to return again because of the effect of restrictions relaxation. I hope in 2022, it would be better, but I don't know, I hope so. And another problem that Jakarta has is air pollution. Air pollution in Jakarta, majority caused by vehicle exhaust, coal combustion, open burning, construction, road dust, pre-suspended soil particles, and secondary aerosol. And the effect of these causes are chronic heart disease, lung disease, diabetes, cancer, and also child health. For example, adverse birth outcomes, slowing lung growth, pneumonia, and stunting. If you can see the capture from the website iqair.com, this is Jakarta Air Quality Index. I capture from Monday, December 13th. So this is the forecast of Jakarta Air Quality Index. Now we are in Thursday, December 16th. The website that today we have unhealthy for sensitive group. So yes, Jakarta sometimes, or maybe majority air pollution in Jakarta cause unhealthy for us. And the other problem is water issues. Jakarta's problems have grown and even worse, driven partly by widespread of pumping groundwater that has caused the land to sink or subside at rapid rates. Now, Jakarta is sinking so fast, according to the National Research and Innovation Agency. In 2050, around 25% of the capital area will be submerged. And this is bad news for us, and I hope it's not gonna happen. And apart from the floods, Jakarta is rapidly growing megacity facing water quality impairment due to pollution, especially water pollution, and a lack of wastewater treatment. And another problem that Jakarta is facing is slum. Yes, of course, Jakarta has many, many skyscrapers, but apart of them, Jakarta has many also slum areas. This because land use distribution is unequal, and there were a lot of settlements on unowned plots of land. A project manager of Mercy Corps Indonesia, Ms. Erlin Sulistianingsi, said that poor sanitation, lack of access to clean water, overcrowding, and poor nutrition are among the major problems in Jakarta. And of course, the government's commitment is needed to address these problems. As you can see, this is Jakarta maps. This is the maps indicates the slum area that Jakarta has. The red indicates the most slum area, and the white is no slum. So we can see North Jakarta has the most slum areas. So a part of those problems, can Jakarta be a tourist destination? First, what is a tourist? What is the destination? According to Buhalis in 2000, destinations are amalgams of tourism products, offering an integrated experience to consumers, to tourists. And most destinations comprise a core of the following components, the 6 A's framework: attractions, accessibility, amenities, available packages, activities, and ancillary services. But 6 A's are not enough. So we have to add a more A, which is attractiveness. Because a destination should have an attractiveness that reflects the feelings, beliefs, and opinions that an individual has about the destination perceived ability to provide satisfaction. This from Hu and Ritchie in 1993. Back in 1981, Mayo and Jarvis conceptualized the notion of destination attractiveness by relating it to the traveler's decision-making process and the specific benefits derived by travelers. And back to 1974, Gehring, Swart, and Farr offering 5 major categories of attractiveness, which are natural factors, social factors, historical factors, recreational and shopping facilities, infrastructure, food, and shelter. And in 2050, Nikolic et al. Modified the attributes of attractiveness by Gehring, Swart, and Farr, and detailing the 5 attributes into these attributes: natural beauty, picturesqueness and tidiness, ecological presentation, preservation, feeling of personal safety, transport, accessibility, quality of accommodation, friendliness of hosts and locals, cultural heritage, entertainment opportunities, quality of restaurants, sports and recreational opportunities, shopping opportunities, and value for money. If we compare the 2074 and 1974 and 2015, we can classify, for example, natural beauty and picturesqueness to natural factor, also ecological preservation to natural factors, and transport accessibility into infrastructure, food and shelter, cultural heritage and friendliness of host and local to social factor, entertainment opportunities to recreational and shopping facilities, quality of restaurants to food, sport and recreational opportunities to recreational, and value for money, social factor. Also, cultural heritage can be put in historical factor also. So what we have in Jakarta, according to this, because the 1974 simpler than 2015, I will follow the guideline from 1974. what we have, what Jakarta has in natural factors. Although Jakarta doesn't have mountains, the city is located in coastline. So Jakarta have chain of smaller island called Thousand Islands, which lies in north of Jakarta's coast. The Thousand Islands offer many tourism activities such as island hopping, mangrove conservation, marine sports and recreation. This is the map of Thousand Islands. This is Jakarta, North Jakarta, and this is the islands. We can do island hopping, for example, from Bidadari to Untung Jawa to Ayer, Ayer Besar, Ayer Kecil, Kelor, Nirwana. We can do island hopping and also mangrove conservation, and of course the marine sports and recreation we can do. And how about the social factors? Generally, Jakarta's diversity extends very well. Like other parts of Indonesia, Jakarta's people are friendly and kindest. As an urban city, Jakarta has urban culture, where presents a great number of different people and background. Of course, the culture also. However, Betawi culture is the embryo culture of Jakarta. Betawi people, as also the native people of Jakarta, considered as native people of Jakarta. And we have Betawi cultural village in Setu Babakan in South Jakarta that reflects how identity and tradition constructed are fragile, especially by the process of rapid urbanization like in Jakarta. How about the historical factors? Before named as megapolitan city, Jakarta experienced a very long history from time to time. The old town area in the Dutch period, in the United East India Company period, the old town area was the center of the city of Batavia before Jakarta got its name of Jakarta. The city was called Batavia in the Dutch period. The government of Dutch in that time, Dendels, moved the center of the government from Old Town, Old Batavia, to Welterfreden area. And we can see the maps, the next slide. And Jakarta has some historical spots or routes to visit. For example, from the Dutch historical history, we can see or we can visit the old town. Also, if you interested to Chinese culture, you can also visit Glodok, Jatinegara, Cikini, Senen, and Pasar Baru. This is the maps. The old towns is around here. The Dendels moved the government to here in 1811. So after Dendels moved here, this area was developing. And we also have recreational and shopping facilities in Jakarta. We have many parks, we have zoo, we have stadium, we have two stadiums. First stadium is in Senayan, the national stadium. And we have another one, the newest one, Jakarta International Stadium. So we have two stadium which has international standards. So also we can have so many options to do commercial activities. We have so many luxurious malls. We have also commercial centers, but we have also traditional markets, and we have so many mini markets and convenience stores to shop. For mini market and convenience stores, every road or every complex, every area have so many mini markets and convenience stores. So don't worry if you want buy something, you can go to mini markets or convenience store in Jakarta. And infrastructure, food and shelter. Jakarta's infrastructure is developing. Transportation, communication, sport facilities, healthcare system, waste management system, we are developing. And there are plenty of accommodation in Jakarta ranging from 1 to 5-star hotels. So you can choose based on your preference. You can also try homestay at some areas, for example, Kemang areas, you can try homestay. And regarding the food and culinary, there are various options to choose from luxurious at hotel to small traditional stall, from Western to Eastern culinary, from meat to vegetarian. So there are plenty options to choose. The question is Jakarta value for money? The provincial minimum wage of Jakarta is 4,416,000 rupiahs. It's approximately $300 per month. So if you want to stay in Jakarta for a month, I think you have to have minimum $300 for a month so you can live. I think it's value for money because I think many other cities, not only in the world, but in Asian, like if I can mention Singapore, Kuala Lumpur, I think it's are more expensive than Jakarta. So the conclusion is, as a megapolitan city, Jakarta is potential to be an attractive tourist destination according to the attributes of attractiveness. However, Jakarta still has many problems to solve, like the congestions, air pollution, slums area, etc. In the future, those problems could be a challenge for the city, both as a tourist destination and as a livable city for the locals. And these are the references that I quote or refers, and also the website references. And that's all. Thank you very much. Terima kasih.
Thank you very much, Ms. Harnadi, for your presentation. It was very interesting as well as open-eyeing for some. Although Jakarta, just like any megapolitan cities, have problems such as flooding and then traffic congestion as well as slums. From all the factors that have been explained, Jakarta do have the ability to become actually a great destination for tourists. Maybe sometimes even for some tourists, these problems could also become a tourist destination.
Yeah, like
slum tourism as well. Thank you again, Ms. Harnadi. Next,
you.
We will go to Ms. Manalo to explain about her presentation. Ms. Manalo, the time is yours.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So I just have two. Just for a while. I think I'm having my technical difficulty. I just have to leave the meeting because I'll be back. I just have to reset my settings for share screen.
this is just one of the problems. If we do have a webinar, connection, internet problems, technical problems, but don't worry, I think she'll be back soon.
Am I loud and clear now?
Yes.
Okay. I was muted and I cannot type. So can you see my screen now? The PowerPoint presentation, can you already see it?
Yes.
Yes, we can see.
All right. So once again, mabuhay ug madayaw. So my name is Eunice Reddit Manalo, for those who are late. I would like to reiterate that I am from the Davao del Norte State College. So I am one of the faculty member from the Bachelor of Science in Tourism Management program. So I am so sorry for the technical difficulty that I have encountered earlier. I really have a hard time sharing my screen at Zoom because I'm using a new laptop. So with that, I would like to welcome each and everyone for the next part of this webinar. I will be discussing the Recognizing Tourism Potential, Mindanao as a Tourist Destination. So my approach is kind of different with Ma'am Agnes, for I will be presenting different tourism attractions in Mindanao. So, okay, so I hope you will... enjoy this very brief presentation about Mindanao. So, All right. So for those Filipino students under the Davao del Norte State College, or if we have other students coming from other school, I will be playing the jingle for the DOT, which is the It's More Fun in the Philippines. And while playing or listening to the song, I want you to comment down on the chat box what are the different words that you hear or that you hear from the jingle. And then we will have a little bit of discussion from that words. This jingle is in Filipino, so I don't think our Indonesian students can understand. So I will be asking our Filipino students to write down words regarding the jingle. Any words are the lyrics of the jingle. So let's play it.
Ba ang iyong mga paa, handa nang umalis, mag-iwaliw at lumarga. Buti na lang taga dito ka, sa dami ng happening, ang dami ng isla. It's more fun.
Actually playing that, I'm also reading the chat box. So for our Indonesian students, so the lyrics of the song is actually the in Filipino, of course, and this is the official jingle for our official slogan, which is It's More Fun in the Philippines. Now with the different, yeah, the comments are still flooding. I really love the interaction. So we have different words coming from the jingle. So we have napakasaya talaga ng Pilipino. It's Filipinos are really more fun. We have may word na chinelas, which means sleeper. So kung if you will be translating, it's more like going on a trip. We also have I didn't see the batanes hanggang hulo. So if you will be listening to the song, it is already mentioned from Batanes, which means from the northern part of the Philippines to the southern part of the Philippines. It's really more fun. So I think earlier when we are having a conversation with our faculty member no from our from the our partner institution. She have mentioned that she has been in the Philippines as well and missed the food. So it's more fun in the Philippines is our slogan because it has been maybe not around the world, but Filipinos are very well known for being resilient and of course smiling even if there's a typhoon or other natural disasters. So that is the trademark. And in the previous years, the slogan of the Philippines are continually changing until the DOT or the Department of Tourism of the Philippines already settled for the slogan, it's more fun in the Philippines. So we've been using this slogan since 2012. Now, to continue, I'm sorry. Oh, ayun lumabas. I'm sorry, the presentation was... Ayan, sorry. Alright, so to continue. Ayan, so this is just a greeting.
Pinipinig, alam ba kung paano nahulog siyo? Naramdaman lang bigla na.
I'm sorry for the interruption. It keeps clicking. Now, for the next discussion, so since I will be presenting the Mindanao, let us see first the map of the Philippines. This is a fun map. Fun map of the Philippines, which means fun map, we're using the term fun map because we are highlighting different activities, different destinations, using the same slogan. For example, commuting. We'll say commuting, more fun in the Philippines. For example, we have like this one in the Visayas part, we have bananas, which is for banana boat. So bananas, more fun in the Philippines. So we have different fun maps. So this is the fun maps. The higher part of the Philippines is from East Luzon. The middle part is Visayas and the southern part of the Philippines is Mindanao. So Philippines consists of 7,641 islands and the three major islands are Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao, being Luzon as the largest island. And so that's the common denominator of Philippines and Indonesia because we are both an archipelago. All right. So the different regions in Mindanao is we have the Caraga region, the Davao region, the Northern Mindanao, the Soksarjan, the Barm, and the Zamboanga Peninsula. So here in the Philippines, when you hear the word Mindanao, coming from our students, can you also type again? When you hear the word Mindanao, what comes to your mind? I mean, you're from Mindanao, but have you heard from your friends from Luzon what is their interpretation or what is their comment when they see or hear the word Mindanao? All right, so war, the land of promise. Keep the comments going. Risk, yes, home of our president, city of life, place of Muslim culture, Marawi, Mindanao is a beautiful place, Davao, resilient. So, ayan, hospitable, bountiful. I have been reading a lot of comments in the comment box. But mostly, if you're not from Mindanao and you're coming from Luzon, Visayas, or being an international tourist, the main perception when they hear or see the word Mindanao is about, all right, terrorism. It's more like terrorism, war, chaos. But we would like to omit that perception. We would like to create a more fun in Mindanao through the different tourism destinations. So we would like to create from Mindanao, with the Mindanao perception from terrorism to tourism, because we are offering different kind of attractions here in Mindanao. So Mindanao is the home for the cleanest, the longest, we have the tallest, the biggest, the highest. So you will know what are those different adjectives that I have described. You will know towards the end of my presentation, you will know what is the cleanest, what is the tallest, what is the longest, what is the highest, what is the biggest. So comparing to Jakarta, as presented by Ma'am Agnes earlier, Jakarta is more on a coastal activity and they don't have the mountains. But in Mindanao, we are having our approach as to islands to highlands approach. Now, from terrorism, we would like to create it's more fun in Mindanao. Now, just like I'm saying earlier, the islands to highlands approach. So we have the Puhada Bay as the first attraction is that we have the Puhada Bay as a member of the most beautiful bays in the World Association. We also have the Sarangani Bay, which is one of the best diving sites in Asia as per the World Travel Awards in 2021. And of course, we have the famous Siargao Island for the Condé Nast Travel Reader's Choice Awards for top islands to visit this 2021. These are just the three bays that can be found in Mindanao. Right. So next one is that aside from bays, we also have different sandbars. So we have the White Island Camiguin. We have the sandbar in White Island Camiguin. And we have also the longest. Ayan. If we already have the cleanest earlier, since cleanest, Puhada Bay being one of the member for the cleanest bay, we have the Panampangan Island, which is the longest sandbar in the Philippines. So yeah, we have the cleanest already and we have the longest. Now for the beaches, Mindanao has really a lot of beaches, ranging from black sand to white sand to fine sand to rocky sand. We even have a charcoal beach called at the Zamboanga. But for this presentation, I will be highlighting two beaches, which is the Santa Cruz Island, which is located in Santa Cruz, Zamboanga. It is also called as the Pink Beach. Why Pink Beach? Because it is said that the pulverized coral have been washed off and mixing with the white sand, making it looks like a pink beach. We also have the Dahican Beach. Now, the Dahican Beach is also known for surfing, but the Siargao, which is all still located in Mindanao, is the surfing capital. Dahican is also having their waves depending on the season, but they are also most well known for their beaches as well and different resorts that can be found in Dahican Beach, which is located in Makati City, Davao Oriental. Now, those are the different approach within the islands. We also have different activities. We also have island hopping, diving, but we will be going to different tourism activities towards the end of this presentation. Next is I would like to highlight the indigenous cultural communities here in Mindanao. So the ICCs or the indigenous cultural communities in Mindanao can be found in the following overlapping regions. We have the South Central Mindanao. We have the Bagobo, Manobo, Kulaman, Blaan, and Tibuli. On this picture, we have the Tibuli tribe, which are actually known for Tinalak. If you can see on my screen, the first slide and as well as the design, here at the top of my presentation, this is actually a pattern for Tinalak. Tinalak weaving is very well known as a culture coming from the Tibuli tribe. The Tibuli tribe are located at the southern part of Mindanao, which is in South Cotabato. So the Tinalak weaving takes a lot of time. I think one yard can be weaved for almost a month. So the tinalak is coming from the abaca fiber, which is very rich. Philippines is very rich in abaca. So it comes from the abaca fiber. And those fiber are being dyed for a I think that's a week. They being dyed and then they are being dyed by a color of the black color. So the tinalak weaving has only three colors. So we have the black, the white, and the red. They are using three major colors, but they have different patterns. So I don't know if you are also familiar with our Miss Universe Catriona Gray. During his promotional video, she featured Lake Cebu actually. Lake Cebu as well as the Tibuli tribe. So the next ICCs that can be found in Mindanao is on the eastern part of the Mindanao, which we have the Mandayang. Mandayang came from the word, the inhabitants of the uplands. Okay? So they also have different rituals ranging from wedding, burial, and festivity. So another ICCs that can still be found in Mindanao or the North Central Mindanao, especially in Bukidnon, is we have the Higaonon. Mostly of the Higaonons are actually living on the top of the tree. So they are known for their tree houses. So you can still see that in the picture. And the last one is the Western Mindanao. We have the different delicacies or cuisine. This is an example of the Maranao cuisine. So this is an example. The picture that shown is an example of a Maranao snacks. And to celebrate the different diversity of the ethnic tribes, one of the city, the major city actually in Mindanao, which is Davao City, includes the different ethnic tribes during the celebration of the Kadayawan Festival. So they have also a beauty contest highlighting the different young women of different tribes or major tribes from Davao City. So they are the activities or beauty contest or the contest is called as the Hiyas ng Kadayawan. So this one I think was in 2019. This is the most recent Hiyas ng Kadayawan, and they are the participants for this event is actually the women coming from the different tribes on the major tribes in Davao City. So now I will be going to different other tourism activities that can be found in Mindanao. So we have the whitewater rafting, which is in Cagayan de Oro. In Davao City, we also have the whitewater rafting. We have also a sightseeing in Samal Island. This is the next picture is the Montfort Bat Cave, which actually holds the Guinness World of Record for the largest colony of fruit bat. Okay, Fruit Bat Cave. And next is we have the Seven Falls in Lake Cebu. Earlier, we have the cleanest. We also have the longest. This is also one of the longest zip line in Southeast Asia and highest zip line in Southeast Asia, the Seven Falls. This activity or this zip line, you will be able to see five falls in Lake Cebu, because the other two falls, you have to hire a guide to trail it. So when you will be availing this activity in Lake Cebu, you will be seeing five of the seven falls for the Lake Cebu. And we also have for another sightseeing in Hinatuan Enchanted River. So this actually river is just a small river. It is just why it is called as Enchanted, because this river is 80 feet deep and it is a saltwater river. So during also at noon, the fishes will swarm in the area, and this is already regulated by the government. So there no swimming is allowed on this part of the river. Now for the heritage tourism, we also have the Rizal Shrine in Dapitan. This is where Jose Rizal is our national hero. So when he was about to be executed, he was exiled in Dapitan, which is in Zamboanga. We also have the Pusan Point. The Pusan Point is where the first sunrise of the millennium. So it is said because if it is located in the eastern part of the Philippines, so it is said that the first sunrise of the millennium, which is in 2000, was here at the Pusan Point. So we also have the Pink Mosque, which is located in Mindanao. And we have the Bangsang Moro Museum in Cotabato. We have different kinds of museum ranging from the museum featuring the UNESCO heritage sites of Mount Hamigitan. We also have museum for the indigenous people, both in Davao City, we have Museo Davaoeno, and here in Tagum City, we have the Kagikan Museum. We have the Dibon Museum, which highlights the different bones of different animals. So we have different kinds of museum in here in Mindanao. And lastly, we also have the Philippine ASEAN Heritage Park. So out of 8 ASEAN Heritage Park of the Philippines, 6 are actually in Mindanao. So they are the Mount Apo, Mount Kitanglad, Mount Malindang Natural Park, Mount Hamigitan Range Natural Park, Mount Timpong Hibok-Hibok Natural Monument, and Agusan Marsh Wildlife Sanctuary. Now, just like I said earlier, we already have the cleanest, the longest, the highest. We also have the, Now we will, Mindanao also houses the tallest. As for the mountain or the most tallest, the tallest mountain in the Philippines can be found in Mindanao, which is Mount Apo Natural Park. It is with a height of 2,954 meters above sea level. And it also houses the biggest bird prey, which is all endemic only in the Philippines, which is the Philippine eagle. So aside from being Philippine ASEAN Heritage Park, Mindanao also take pride that one of the ASEAN Heritage Park is also a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And that can also be found here in Mindanao. We have the Mount Hamigitan Range Wildlife Sanctuary. So Mount Hamigitan Range, this is Mount Hamigitan Range, the second. This is Mount Apo. The reflection is actually from Lake Binado. And this one is Mount Hamigitan. So as you can see here in Mount Hamigitan is very, very famous for its pygmy forest. Now, why is it called the pygmy forest? Because as you go higher on the elevation of Mount Hamigitan, the forest does not grow anymore because of the minerals located at the Mount Hamigitan. However, because of the intervention from the LGU or the government, Mount Hamigitan did not become a mining mountain. Instead, it became a UNESCO World Heritage Site, because the government doesn't want Mount Hamigitan to be mined. So instead, they preserved the Mount Hamigitan, and now it became, aside from being an ASEAN Heritage Park, it also became as the UNESCO World Heritage Park. So those are the different destinations that can be found in Mindanao. But just like what Ma'am Agnes said, we also have different problems that can be faced here also in Mindanao. Aside from terrorism, we also have the congestion of the traffic. However, the continuous projects, intergovernment projects, led us to highlight different destinations here in Mindanao. So again, when you go to Mindanao, that will be a islands to highlands package that will include different tourism activities ranging from beaches, to the people, to food, to infrastructure, and to natural attractions up to the mountains. We also have other activities we also have the skydiving here in Mindanao, which is actually can be found at General Santos City. I was not able to include here. But there are also different parks, flower parks that can still be found in Mindanao. So I think that will be the end of my presentation for Mindanao as a tourism attraction. I would really like to take this opportunity to invite everyone to really visit Mindanao, as we have been neglected in the past few years because of the threat of terrorism. But we would really like to encourage that instead of terrorism, let's make Mindanao a tourism destination. Okay, so with that, I think that will be the end of my presentation. Once again, salamat at mabuhay.
Thank you, Ms. Eunice. I think you succeeded with your presentation for us to be interested to coming to Mindanao, because it's a beautiful presentation showing all the beautiful attraction that we can actually see in Mindanao. Okay, so we will now go to the question and answer session. So if any of the audience want to ask a question to any of the two presenters that we have, please raise your hand so I know who is asking the question, and then I will say your name and you can ask the question to the one of the presenters. Okay, I see one raised hand. Juan Sebastian, you may ask your question, Juan.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, so may I ask a question? Okay,
yeah.
So good afternoon. Magandang hapon to all the participants and Ms. Yunis. Ms. Atlas as the one to look at the address here. I'm Juan from First Department of Unikat Majaya, Jakarta. I would like to ask several only two major questions to Ms. Yunis Manalo. This is regarding, yeah.
I'm sorry, I can hear you, but it's I think the surroundings is not
can you hear me now?
I can hear you, but not that clear, sir.
Ah, okay, sorry. I'm outside that. Yeah, outside the okay. So my question is regarding the issue that you said before about the Mindanao, like the one you said, Mindanao is currently facing the terrorism issue. But tourism, we all know that tourism sector needs to be to be secure for all the tourists in terms of security. And if we look at the tourism activities, that I don't know if it's still currently happening in Mindanao or not, or it's like it's, I don't know, but regarding the terrorism issue, is it still happening now in Mindanao, and how it may affect the tourism sector there besides the pandemic situation? And secondly, what would like us to regarding the infrastructure that are available in Mindanao for tourism? Like you said, Mindanao has so many places of tourism, like the mountain, like the beach, like the sun. And how is it possible to reach Mindanao in terms of not only by transportation, but the infrastructure there to reach the destination? Are there any problems or urgency in building the infrastructure for all the tourists? Thank you.
Sir, I would like to reiterate your question, sir. No, so it's really not clear, but one of the questions that I have understand is that is terrorism still present in Mindanao and how it was addressed, and that what are the intervention for the terrorism? Actually, sir, terrorism is still it's still existing in Mindanao. However, because of the close communication between the tourism offices as well as our armies, of course, it is safe to say that it is safe really to travel in Mindanao. How do I say so? Back in 2018, since I am also want to advocate, I just stayed in Mindanao again that time for a year. And I was from Luzon by that time. I came back to Mindanao. So it was in 2017, I came back in Mindanao. And in 2018, just to prove that let's wipe out the perception that Mindanao is all about terrorism, I traveled alone at the southernmost part of the Philippines, which is in Tawi-Tawi. I think some islands in Tawi-Tawi is actually near in Indonesia and Malaysia. Because it's already the southern part of the Philippines. I really traveled alone by that time just to prove that really Mindanao is not, though terrorism is still present, but it is safe. And so far, there are no records of here in major regions of Mindanao, there are no records for tourists being involved in other terrorism attacks. Now, by that time, I came back alive. And I mean, I'm alone by that time. I'm a woman, I'm alone, but I came back safe. Because really, Mindanao is, you know, the terrorism is present, but we have different areas for tourism. And however, when I also traveled by that time, since I really want to travel the Barm region by that time, which will include Basilan, Tawi-Tawi, and Sulu, I was advised that I should not make a DIY, do it your own, in Jolo, in a province in Jolo. So there's a warning for the government if you want to travel. So they have warned me that if I want to travel in Jolo, so I should not do a DIY. Instead, contact to the tourism office. And if you want to go to different attractions, they will accompany you together with the army. So you will be escorted with an army. So that's how the intervention. But here in Davao region, in other regions in Mindanao, not just in the southern part, you can freely actually do a DIY tour in Mindanao, sir. Yes, it is safe and cost efficient if you really do a DIY. But we really encourage, of course, for international tourists to get travel agencies or to contact travel agencies to ensure your travel will be more memorable. But the second question, sir, I think I did not get it properly, sir.
I think the second question is it about infrastructure, Juan?
Oh, okay, infrastructure.
About how, because there are a lot of, it's an archipelago in Mindanao also, and then there are many places of tourism, such as natural tourist destinations, and how do you build the infrastructure without actually damaging the natural resources there?
Yes, on the infrastructure side, there are two departments working for when you're developing a tourism site in the Philippines. That would be the Department of Tourism and the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. So that's the DOT and DNR. So they closely monitoring and they closely work with each other if you want to develop a site, most especially those that are a natural attraction. Most especially if it's at a Seyan Heritage Park. So I work at Mount Apo, which is, I already mentioned, the tallest mountain in the Philippines under the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. So by that time, if you are planning to create an infrastructure or create an ecotourism site, there are policies made by the board of the protected area, as well as the administrative orders coming from the DNR. We have a set policies of what kind of infrastructure are you going to build there? Is it allowed? So those infrastructures are being built in the multiple use zone. There are three zonings in an ecotourism site. We have the multiple use zone, the buffer zone, and we have the strict protection zone. So it is being ensured that the strict protection zone will be a no human activity, and that all other tourism activities and other economic activities will be within the buffer and the multiple use zone. So as per the infrastructure, we have different policies to consider when making an infrastructure in the tourism area. And from in the roadside, that will be a DOT, another two two interagency, that would be DOT and the Department of Public and Work and Highways. We call them DPWH. So they have this program, DOT-DPWH Convergence Program, wherein they will be building roads or creating roads from the main, from the city to the tourism sites. So it actually depends on what infrastructure are you going to build, but there will be closely monitoring between DOT and other government agencies. So that's the intervention here in the Philippines.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Eunice. Juan, does that answer your question?
I hope I answer your question, Sir Juan.
Okay, any other question from the audience? For Ms. Eunice or Ms. Agnes? Okay, there. Oh, no. Maraming salamat po.
Wala ka naman, ma'am. I think we have... what is... how do you say salamat in Indonesia?
We say terima kasih.
Terima kasih. But you also have different dialect as well, ma'am, in Jakarta.
I think, yes, we do. We have different dialects. In Jakarta, we also have a different dialect. But we have... one national Bahasa language, it is Bahasa Indonesia.
Yes. So same here in the Philippines, our national language is Filipino. But here in Mindanao, most of the dialect is Bisaya. So like the what I said earlier, the Madayaw is actually it's a Bisayan term for like a welcoming word.
So is it almost like mabuhay?
Yeah, mabuhay is a Filipino word for welcoming Madayaw. Guests. So, Madayaw is the dialect. It's more like a dialect term for mabuhay.
Ah, okay.
Bisaya term. So, it's mabuhay and Madayaw.
Mabuhay and Madayaw. Okay.
Yes.
We also have some, some terms that actually means the same, like sayang and stuff like that. So there are certain terms in our language and as well as your language that has the same meaning, like mahal.
I think there are other, we have other words actually coming from the Indonesian word as well. And actually the Malaysian, I think we also have like almost the same words.
So is there any more questions from the audience?
Yeah, do you have any other questions?
I think if there are no other questions, maybe I guess we have come to the end of the webinar. So I think we are at the end of the webinar. We can close it. Please give another icon of applause or your reaction to our two speakers. Okay, thank you again, Ms. Agnes Harnadi and Ms. Eunice Manalo, for giving your time to join us here and give your presentation. Thank you everyone also for being here. Wish you all a blessed day. I also hope to see you again on our next joint e-webinar. But before you go, could we do a picture?
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe I ask Ms. Zarin here to take a picture of us. So please, everyone, can you turn your video cam on so we can take a picture?
But before you go, you have to fill the feedback in this. Don't forget the participant to fill the feedback in this link.
There is a feedback tourism potential. You can fill it in, and inside there is also if you want a certificate for your participation in this e-webinar, you could also choose that. So fill in your name as well as your email or so that we could send it to you. So Ms. Zarin, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Yes.
Countdown.
So wait. Okay, gallery view. We have 11 pages here. So I'm going to count for each pages. So page one, please smile. Okay, 1, 2, 3. And then second page. 1, 2, 3. I saw some posts there. Okay, what page 3? 1, 2, 3. And page 4. 1, 2, 3. Page 5. 1, 2, 3 for page 5. And page 6. Okay, so no one open their camera on page 6. I think that's all for our picture session.
Okay, thank you, Zarin.
You're welcome.
And I think to look at the participants, there's 267 participants for our first joint e-webinar. So that's great for us. And hopefully this will not be our last joint e-webinar. So hopefully next year we have another joining webinar and we can see each other again at that time.
Yes, actually, ma'am, we're really looking forward for this partnership and linkages. Actually, this is the first time for our school, and we really look forward for more activities between our school and our your school and our school.
Yeah, hopefully after this pandemic, we could actually visit there.
Oh, that's good.
Maybe asking our students also to go there.
Could have a faculty and student exchange.
Yes, that would be great also.
Okay, so then. I really hope that this pandemic will end.
Yes. So thank you, everyone, for attending this webinar. I hope to see you soon. Thank you, Ms. Agnes.
Thank you so
much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you,
everybody.
Thank you, Mr.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.